farewell.
Kiss me while you can, boys. I've bidding you farewell.
But, Madam Miriam, you can't leave yet. There's still the sharp shooting contest. Parson Tuck, if we lose, the bank's gonna foreclose on the schoolhouse.
I thought for sure that masked gunslinger was gonna save the day.
No, Robin Hood got put in jail for robbing the railroad tycoons and giving the money back to the farmers.
What do you say to that, Madam Marion?
Would you like us to
hold your horses one second? I see someone taking aim at this here target.
But he can't win. There's already a bullet smack dab in the middle of the bullseye.
Why, he shot that other bullet in half! No, not quite yet. Why, he shot that other bullet in half!
Look, it's Rob Hood!
I wasn't the face belongs to those lips. I long to kiss.
This face.
Why, you're Alan O'Dell, that friendly lawman from the East I was so crazy about. I thought you were all done with us.
Now, when I finally found myself home, a place where I belong, keeping company with the people I care most about.
You came to us a stranger, in this place of crap, and gave us new hope in ourselves. That's gonna be one tough act to follow.
Well, how's this? Will you be my lawful wedded wife, Miss Nancy?
Oh, yes, I will!
Why not? I've been carrying her all night.
Robin Hood is running in Boston.
How about, calls to mind Walt Disney's Pinocchio, because its star is wooden, ought to be hung by piano wire, and swallowed by the first whale that enters the Boston Harbor.
Who said that?
The Christian Science Monitor.
Carmen, you're the producer. I've sunk last year's profits from my 1958 lingerie line into this show. There's gotta be something in the papers we can use.
Let me consult with our writing team. Georgia, Aaron, does debacle have two meanings?
No.
No.
Well, that's a shame, critics. Who would make a living by killing other people's dreams? I mean, what kind of man would take a job like that? What kind of slob would take a job like that? Who could be mean enough, base and obscene enough to take a job like that?
Wait a second. Here's something in the Herald that might be good.
Formerly married composer and lyricist Aaron Fox and Georgia Hendrix have provided film star Jessica Cranshaw with a star vehicle that ought to be driven off a cliff.
What kind of mom would raise her boy like that?
Who would want her baby destroyed like that?
Who could be jerk enough, hard up or work enough to want a job like that? Who'd want to grow to be everyone's enemy? Critics are hated and so excoriated. Tell me what kind of man would want a job like...
Hey, get a load of this! The Cambridge Patriot says, considering the talent and experience of the veterans involved, Robin Hood is sure to be a huge Broadway smash.
What kind of genius has a mind like that? So perspicacious, wise, and kind like that. Far from his mother's seat, she must be thrilled to see how he grew up to be such brilliant company. Refined and reflective, completely objective, but it lifts up your heart to meet a man like that.
But the Cambridge Patriot is not the Boston Globe. The Globe is the review that we needed.
Funny, none of them mentioned Jessica fainting. She fainted during the bows, which is when the critics dash out of the theater and dash off their postmortems. Face it, we've gotten our notice and we've been given notice.
I'm afraid you're right.
No. You two are just oversensitive because you wrote the show. This is only round one. The first musical my husband and I produced was Savaged Out of Town. So, we rolled up our sleeves, did a major rewrite, and brought it to Broadway. And that musical, my friends, was Kiss Me, I'm Irish. Close before the audience opened their playbills. But the point is, this is a Sydney and Carmen Bernstein production. We decide if it goes to New York, not Daryl Grady of the Boston Globe.
So we're still shooting for Broadway?
Georgia, Aaron, you keep writing tunes that bounce. Olive, you keep writing checks that don't.
Very nice, but until our leading lady gets out of the hospital, then who knows what happens next.
Hey, just have her under observation. I'm sure she'll be out by the morning.
Is there no limit?
Sounds like our director.
Is there no limit?
He got such horrendous reviews.
Is there no limit? I ask you, to my unbridled brilliance.
Chris, where were you tonight? I put a lot of money into the show. As our director, you and all of us.
Oh, be still your foolish mouth. Nothing to be gleaned by watching one show with a fraudulent audience of an opening night. Went for a walk past the Cathedral of the Holy Cross. Went in wildly spiritual. I tell you, those Catholics really know how to put on a show. Then suddenly, in the middle of the Eucharist, I had an epiphany. In this state of life of any musical, one must refrain from inventing anything brilliant, but simply eliminate all that's awful. What, I ask without fear of contradiction, was the most awful thing in our show?
Jessica.
Of course. Carmen, I came back to get you to get rid of our star, only to have the cast inform me that she's in the hospital. I see the hand of the Lord in this.
Mrs. Bernstein, there's a call for you in your office.
Thanks, Jenny. That's probably my husband calling.
And where was Sydney tonight, Carmen?
Sydney's in New York, booking a theater for us, and knowing my husband, also booking a soprano who doesn't dance but knows how to move.
At least she can joke about it.
It's easy to joke about marriage and men like Sydney, and you don't take it seriously.
There's no comparison. I never did more than flirt with any woman in any cast once you and I got married.
Barbara O'Brien.
She was an usher! That was only after you moved out.
Oh, so you finally looked up from your music and noticed that I was gone.
Jenny, you're the stage manager. How's the cast taking the reviews?
They decided to dress the nines at the rock competition opening and closing night party.
Defeatist lot of you. You have yet to hear my plan of action, but hit it ye shall. Jenny, come help me watch you set up the piano.
What plan? You think he wants us to go to Broadway using an understudy?
Well, at least we'd still have Bobby in the title role.
Yeah, and that's what matters, right? I mean, the whole reason you teamed up with me again was so you could rekindle a romance with our leading man.
Aaron, when I signed up, I had no idea that Bobby would be on the show.
Really?
Okay.
Then, why at our very first rehearsal did you walk right up to him and say...
Hi, Bobby.
Hi, sweetie. Ooh. Well, looks like everyone's going back to New York a little sooner than we thought. But if you and I are heading back together, that's one thought that's a big hit with me.
Eh bien, mes enfants. A brief demonstration of what's been wrong with this show since its very first love song.
You mean Thinking of Him? That's one of my best songs in the show.
One of our best songs.
See, Georgia agrees with me.
Nonetheless, I've had a problem with that song since our very first rehearsal. Georgia, sing of a leading lady's opening number.
Which song is this?
The one with the new lyric Georgia wrote about me.
About Rob Hood.
Precisely. And in play, Georgia sing, Jenny, put her in light Q5.
Light Q5? This is silly. I haven't sung on stage in years.
Just sing.
Been wrong with that tune since our very first rehearsal, then you'll have to tell me what.
Is that we ever allowed Jessica Crenshaw to sing it?
Yeah, that's right.
Now, people, I think it's a crying shame that our leading lady collapsed at tonight's performance. She could have done it weeks ago and saved us a month of misery. But the cavity that Jessica has created must be appropriately filled.
May I speak? As Jessica's understudy, I feel terrible taking over under these circumstances.
No need to feel terrible, Nikki.
But
no need, because you're still going to be the understudy. To Georgia.
Georgia?
Best idea you've ever had.
She hasn't danced in years.
Anything's better than Jessica.
I don't know, Chris.
You know the score and script better than anyone else. You sing the songs from your heart because that's where the words came from. I realize it's been some time since you treated me in your tap shoes with a rhyming dictionary, but...
Excuse me, but speaking for those of us in the chorus, I really think Nikki should get the role. She's talented and dedicated.
And since you're her understudy, if she got the lead, you would get her part.
Well, yes, that too.
Nice try, Bambi, but either Georgia's in or I'm out. What do you say, Olive?
Chris, I'll put my money where your mouth is.
Launder it first. Erin, I assume this move only meets with your approval.
No. To be honest, it doesn't.
Thanks for the vote of confidence.
I have my reasons.
You always have.
Besides, this entire debate is pointless if Jessica shows up tomorrow.
Heaven help us. She was worse than ever this evening.
Jessica Cranshaw will never be better than she was this evening.
But she was horrible.
I know. But she'll never be better. She's dead. That was the hospital on the phone. In terms of future performances, Jessica Cranshaw now has a conflict.
What happened?
They wouldn't tell me.
Chris, do you want to say something to the company about Jessica?
Can we all have a minute of silence to reflect the audience's response to Jessica's first number?
Chris!
Well, all right. Let's all form a semicircle. Boy, girl, boy, girl. Tallest on the inside.
No, Bambi, you're blocking the entire right side of the house!
People, Jessica was part of our company and now we part company. I'm sure we'll all remember her in our thoughts and in our resumes. And now, as thespians, I know you would like to display your sorrow as both a tribute and as an acting exercise. Sasha, F sharp minor.
See for yourself. Lieutenant Frank Chalky of the Greater Boston Police. I'm assigned to the Homicide Division, and oh, it is just an honor to be standing on the same stage as each and every one of you! Genuinely deserves. I happen to cast Robin Hood in previews, and let me say that with the exception of the deceased Miss Cranshaw, you are all such wonderful performers. And what a score!
Oh, well, I appreciate that, Lieutenant.
And on behalf of my half of that compliment, thanks as well.
You're all very welcome. I happen to do a little community theater myself. Oh, no, nothing that fancy. Although my Billy Bigelow at Brooklyn Barnhouse got a favorable review. And in the midst of Versailles Street, my bottom was very well received.
And you say you're from Homicide?
Well, yes. Based on the preliminary autopsy, it's clear that Miss Jessica Cranshaw was murdered.
And then what are they going to do with her killer? I mean, is it some sort of trophy or a Pontiac convertible?
Chris.
Sorry. Pure reflex.
What killed her?
Hydrocyanic acid. Commonly used in electroplating as well as the gas chamber in San Quentin. It was in capsule form, which is why no one noticed she had been poisoned until the capsule dissolved in her stomach. Studying a chemical reaction that created her own personal gas chamber. Internally.
Horrible.
Working backwards from when the capsule dissolved, we know she swallowed them in the show's last 10 minutes.
Couldn't she have poisoned herself?
Trauma at the back of the throat suggests she didn't take them voluntarily. Now, may I ask who's in charge here, other than myself?
Permit me, Lieutenant. I'm the critically acclaimed director, Christopher Bennett, and I will be blocking your investigation.
I hope it's not the case. But if you need to wrap things up with the cast, please go right ahead.
Well, company, I'm sure you will all give Georgia the support she needs as she steps into the late Miss Crenshaw's shoes.
That's brilliant.
As one would expect from me. And now, I would like to see a show of hands of who's ready to press forward with Robin Hood and Georgia.
That's it? Listen, people, life is full of setbacks and disappointments, as my husband once demonstrated to me in the bridal suite of the Hotel Taft. But with Georgia taking the lead, we've got ourselves a real shot. The show is going on! Are you with me, gang?
You know, if we leave now, we can catch the last train back to New York.
Stop! It's clear that every one of you is in perfect physical condition, so the show as old as time itself, there's a grand theatrical tradition that the show must go on.
Forget it! I've got a contract.
You signed a contract? Go read your contract. And I will count to 10 and then I'll sue you. Oh yes, I'll sue you. And when I sue you, you'll never work again.
Excuse me, but who's equity representative?
I am. Mrs. Bernstein, as equity deputy, I must warn you, any further threats and you'll be brought up on charges.
Oh, shut up, Elaine.
The name's Bambi.
Mother? All right. Let's put it this way. For the backer's sake of asking your permission to let the show go on.
No.
The show must go on. The show must go on.
Why?
Because I say the show must go on.
I can't believe I'm hearing this. I won't believe it. Putting on a show has got to be the most fulfilling thing a person could ever hope to do. You people, you're all heroes to me.
You're a special kind of people known as show people. You live in a world of your own. The audience pay plenty to sit there and clap. hearing you sing, watching you tap. Did you know your dentist longs to be in show business? Your window washer wants to be a star. Though your analyst may never couch it that way.
Analyst couch!
You don't know how lucky you are. Some policemen and detectives dream of show business. They can't get arrested, but still, they sit around this station and fancy this life. They jeer Sherlock Holmes and cheer Mac the Knife.
Ask your cleaning lady, don't you dream of show business to vocalize your stretch beside a bar?
Her affirmative shrug as she shampoos your rug lets you know how lucky you are.
There's a special kind of aura around a show person. Just ask the next waiter you meet.
He walks in fifth position, his voice is just grand.
He gives you the check, you give him a hand.
If the boys in valet parking turn to show business, they could scalp a higher ticket for your car.
And my tree surgeon now started singing a bell.
A bell, get it? B-O-U-G-H.
Don't you know how lucky you are?
Particularly memorable. It was just lovely.
Well, thank you.
Lovely.
Well, thank you.
Oh, I'm crazy about your little vibrato.
You're very kind. Anyway, yesterday, Miss Cranshaw asked me to coach on her lines, and of course I said I'd be happy to help.
That's so like you.
Well, I'm also her understudy. At least I was. I guess I'm Georgia's now. But then these three letters fell out of Miss Cranshaw's script. She didn't take them seriously, but I kept them. I'm afraid my fingerprints are all over them. They're death threats. See, words and letters have been pasted onto the paper, cut with little curved finger scissors from a newspaper or magazine. I would imagine.
You're murdering the score, but I'll murder you. You'll drop before the curtain does. If you don't quit, you'll die. Legit.
Can you tell anything from them?
Oh, they seem pretty negative in spirit.
Well, yes, of course.
Oh, I'm sorry. We opened for the Arthur Conan Doyle version. Unfortunately, these notes reveal very little. Except that the person who sent them is a man in his early 30s, 6'4" in height, and wears a pupil ring and works in the Merchant Marines, and despite being right-handed, is known to his closest friends as Lefty.
How ever did you know that?
Oh, I didn't. I was just saying that. I bet you hoped I could tell. Wow. I mean, if I could tell that from that?
Wow. Gee. For a second, I was impressed, as I once told my husband in the bridal suite of a hotel. Well, how about we all head across the street and have ourselves one slobber knocker of a wake for the late, if less than great, Jessica Cranshaw. Drinks are on me.
I'm sorry. The theater's quarantined. I have been posted to all the exits and, none of you can leave.
I'm sorry.
All of you will be staying here in the theater until further notice. Emergency services will bring in cots and meals.
Wait a second. The talented members of this cast are entitled to a day off. The talented members and even you, Elaine.
Listen. Correct me if I'm wrong here, but to the best of my recollection, Jessica Cranshaw never left the stage in the show's last 10 minutes. If so, then I'm sorry, but she had to have been murdered by one of you. I've never had this many suspects before, and I can't have each of you followed around the clock. Better I keep you all on lock and key until I solve this crime.
You're taking the law into your own hands, Trophy.
Well, that's sort of what I'm paid to do. That's why I got this badge and this gun. Pew, pew. Anyway, being sequestered here could help you focus on fixing the show.
Fixing?
Keep your hands off me, you hear? Who's that?
Sounds like my husband on his best behavior.
I guess he left New York.
Lucky New York.
Well, isn't this just peachy keen? You all waited up for me. Jenny, I'm still wearing my coat.
Sorry, Mr. Bernstein.
Sydney, it's been an awful night.
I hear you, Chris.
And I'm turning in my resignation!
I can't hear you, Chris. How are you holding up, Olive?
Oh, can't complain.
That's right, you can't.
Welcome back to Boston, Sydney.
Well, hello.
It's me, Sydney, your stepdaughter.
Oh, sorry about that, Fawn.
It's Bambi.
And last but not least, Mrs. B, my junior partner and lesser half.
All right, let's just get this over with, Sydney.
What? You expect me to be upset? I returned... Oh, yeah, I left you in charge of opening night and returned to find a dead leading lady, deadly reviews, and a bunch of cops who tell me I can't leave this theater!
I'm afraid you've arrived at the wrong time for you and just the right time for me, Mr. Bernstein.
Excuse me?
Lieutenant Frank Chaffee. Now, while all you folks are go about your various tasks as if this weren't the scene of a homicide, Detective Victor Coles went downstairs for your pertinent information. I want you to give him your name, address, and 8x10 glossy. And I'll be having questions for all of you in the morning. Pleasant dreams, everyone.
Lieutenant, I can't possibly be the suspect. I was in Manhattan when Jessica got murdered.
Can you prove that?
It just so happens I was keeping company with a young actress on Sutton Place. If I give you her name, it could ruin her reputation.
Your chivalry is touchingly convenient.
Lieutenant, I have many influential friends in New York City.
Too bad you're in Boston.
And will you be wanting me any further, Lieutenant?
Oh, no. But I do have some questions for your boyfriend.
Oh, I don't have a boyfriend.
Oh. Actually, I'd like to take you into my confidence regarding this investigation.
Why is that, Lieutenant?
Well, if I don't, there's really no reason for us to keep talking.
Well, then take me into your confidence with confidence, Lieutenant.
There's something really wrong going on here. I just met an opening night cast who seemed incredibly eager to close.
Well, I can understand how they might feel. They all left wonderful jobs and hit Broadway musicals to work up here in Boston. I've never performed outside of this city, and Bambi's had to fight her mother at every step just to be in the chorus. The entire cast is overworked and underpaid, but surely not enough to drive any of them to murder.
Keep in mind, I'm within arm's reach any hour, day and night.
You think I'm in some danger?
No, that was a completely unrelated thought.
You live with danger on a daily basis, don't you, Lieutenant?
Oh, most of the time it's just paperwork and procedure. Detectives have no opening night, Miss Harris. We make our entrance after the curtain has fallen on someone else's life.
But it's a calling, isn't it? Like a doctor or a teacher?
Or an actor.
I suppose you're right. I can't imagine doing anything else with my life. It's not wrong to be married to one's work, is it?
No, not at all. Well, sometimes it's no honeymoon. I like my job. I really do. And if I say so myself, I'm good at it too. I catch the bad guys, well, most of the time. So it's a good life. A perfectly good life. Not exactly sublime. When I finish my work and I crawl into bed, I reflect as I turn out the light that the day that's to come and the week that's ahead will be lunch counter mornings and coffee shop nights. Lunch counter mornings and coffee shop nights.
Well, it's reassuring to have such a dependable schedule, like matinees every Wednesday.
Or Bristol and Rob PG's Thursday.
With your friends.
I like my pals. The guys on the force. We're not very social. They're all married, of course. Sometimes we go bowling or have a few beers. So it's a fine life. A perfectly fine life. I'd give it 2 cheers. 'Cause sometimes I think at the end of the day, when I've read The Last Burglar, his rights, the life that I lead is a little bit gray, with its lunch counter mornings and coffee shop nights. Lunch counter mornings and coffee shop nights.
But your acting roles, don't they make for a change?
Oh, Miss Harris, each year from May 23rd to the 12th of June, when I turn my life over to the Swallow Street Plays, that's more than a vacation to me. It's an overture of hope, the curtain rising of the greatest joy of my life. The rest of the year, the life that I lead, it's a little bit gray. There are plenty of low days and not many highs. Mostly lunch counter mornings and coffee shop. I don't mean before, but might I walk you home?
Oh, I'd be delighted, but you said we aren't allowed to leave. Damn!
Just great.
Impossible, I know, but somehow I do it.
If one of you is the killer, would you please take her next?
Detective O'Farrell's here with your last collection of clothes from your hotel rooms. Collect your bundle downstairs, and in half an hour, Lieutenant Chaffee will be questioning all altos and tenors.
Ah, your lieutenant rising out of your interrogation chamber to grace us with your presence.
I thought I'd stretch my legs a little bit. I've been stuck in that green room all day.
At least you got to sleep in your own bed last night.
Sorry about that.
I intrigue you, don't I, Lieutenant?
Yes, both as a director and a suspect.
I got what you asked for, Lieutenant.
Oh, thank you. Oh, and did you get those clothes from Nikki Harris I asked for?
Blues and greens, just like you asked. Are you trying to set some kind of trap for her?
No, I'm trying to match her eyes.
Heads up, I'm opening the elevator curtain.
Excuse me, Lieutenant Frank Chaffee, homicide. You mind telling me who you are and how you got in here?
Oh, as a member of the press, I'm exempt from your quarantine, Lieutenant. Daryl Grady of the Boston Globe.
After the review you gave Robin Hood, I can't imagine why you show your face here of any places.
I'm as mystified as you. The show's producers called and asked me to pay a visit.
That's right. Carmen Bernstein. Mr. Grade, you have our thanks for coming by, if not for your review.
Look, I tried my hardest to say something good about your production. I praised the choreography and that young woman who played the school mom, Nikki,
Harris.
Well, I'm afraid it's all history now. My condolences on the loss of your star and your show.
When you interviewed me last week, I told you that we're going to Broadway, no matter what you wrote about us.
We're keeping Robin Hood open, and once we've ironed out the kinks, we're asking you to review it again, with Georgia Hendricks in the lead.
Georgia Hendricks? Your lyricist? But she hasn't been in the show for years. That's some story, and yes, there is a precedent for reappraising a show with a new lead. Tell you what, I'll re-review your show tomorrow night.
Tomorrow?
It's the best I can do. And to be fair, not many shows can survive two bad reviews from the Boston Globe in 1 week.
Carmen, go tell the cast that we've got 24 hours to hold a week of rehearsals. If you fail, we will live to regret it.
Sydney, I guess the reason you're such a lowlife is because they built you so close to the ground. Oh, good day, Lieutenant. Oh,
you just made it one, Miss Harris.
That dress goes very nicely with your eyes, Miss Nikki.
Thank you.
Oh, I can't believe it, Mr. Daryl Grady. Am I allowed to offer my thanks for the kind words you wrote?
Please don't misunderstand, Miss Harris, but I try not to fraternize with the artists I review. But let me say, you did stand out in what was otherwise an abundantly misguided production.
I found your review of Robin Hood to be needlessly cruel and way off the mark.
I'm not sure you know how to judge acting, Lieutenant.
Oh, of course. You're the expert. However, I regret to inform you that I'm placing you under arrest for the crime of murder.
What? Have you lost your mind?
Anything you say can be taken out of writing and used against you and the court of law.
This is insane. What are you saying?
I'm saying... My best lines are back at the Christine's murder at the Vicarage. I played Chief Inspector Slack in Nighttown Players 2 summers ago. Oh, gosh, did you think I was saying that for real? I'm not sure you're a good judge of acting, Mr. Grady. We can go.
Come on, Grady. I'll walk you to the door.
Swell acting, Lieutenant! And not just on a community theater level. I mean college.
Thank you.
And how's your investigation going, if I may ask?
I've been going over the show's financials, and you know, you're right. Everyone here is getting paid the same equity minimum, and not just the newcomers like you and Bambi, but your stars as well. Look, this isn't the best place to talk. Why don't you and I go out for a little and,
You won't let me leave.
Damn. Lieutenant, you must clear the stage immediately. I've just been informed that I have less time to reinvent this show than Moses had to cross the Red Sea. And he had God on his side.
Hey, is this true? I'm getting reviewed tomorrow?
Nikki, go fetch Bambi. I have no choice but to re-block in the same boat here and now.
Well, I'm gonna have to watch this.
Why? Do you think something's gonna happen?
No, I just really like this number. Although...
What?
Oh, it's nothing.
What?
Oh, I can't believe I'm about to say this.
What is it?
I don't think that simply changing the choreography is gonna help. I mean, the song itself is kind of lackluster. It lacks...
Yes?
Luster. Three women on the Arkansas River in a rowboat that's sinking fast, trying to make it to the federal courthouse in Wichita before the farmers lose their land. It's great stuff! Your 11 o'clock number! But the music itself is kind of... I wonder, can we hear some of it?
Ladies, sing for the lieutenant. Chaffee, this one's for you.
In the same boat, on the same sea, shaking inside as the tide keeps rising. Nary a ship, nary a sail, nary a soul on the whole horizon. Still we are not discouraged. Due to the ancient quote that you're likely to win, take it all on the chin like
You see what I'm saying? For such a big moment in the show, the song is kind of mild-mannered.
Strangely enough, I agree. We need a completely new composition, one that's catchier than Pinka.
Oh, you want a hit?
Yes, and not some song from one of your failed shows either, Aaron. None of your eine kleine trunk music.
Listen, Chris, if you expect me to come up with anything, you're gonna have to find me just a little bit of private time with my piano and my writing partner.
Your writing partner is now my dancing partner and the star of this show. If she doesn't get the saloon number under her belt tonight, we're all finished.
And I need to see that wedding number and full dress regalia this instant. Jenny, tell the cast to change for the Act 1 finale and the final bars on the bar at the Barbie Bar Salute.
Say again?
I can't say that again.
Chris's rehearsal takes priority, so those of you who need to change costume, please go right ahead. The rest proceed to the green room where Detective O'Farrell will be fingerprinting the entire company. That should buy you a few minutes alone with your piano, Mr. Fox.
Alone. Yeah.
Must be quite the challenge. To write when your partner is
otherwise engaged.
Can I ask you a question? Only because I've wondered this my entire life. What would usually come first? The music or the lyric?
Same answer as the chicken or the egg.
Ah, so it's the lyric.
No. A great melody doesn't always need a lyric. Or a lyricist.
Then how do you start?
Well, it can start with a note, which can become a phrase, and then you try hanging words off each branch, like trimming a tree.
Sounds easy enough.
Really? Well, don't talk about love. Or you'll have to say fits like a glove. Or as certain as push comes to shove, you will pine for the woman you're constantly thinking of. You see the problem?
You're not even part of it. Suggest staying away from love?
At all costs. And don't mention your life. Or you'll have to say cuts like a knife. Or refer to the heartbreaking strife when you find it you're missing your...
Missing?
What?
You were saying what you missed.
I meant that, I miss the music. I miss the song. Since she's not with me, comes out wrong. It doesn't matter how hard I try. I've lost the music, and I don't know why. You may have known before I met her, I wrote a writing a song, and you've a partner whom is filled with jokes and chatter. She says something, and you say something. She writes a line, and you play a vamp. But when you're writing a song without a partner, that's a completely different matter. No one tells you that's not funny. No one says, let's cut that bar. No one makes you better than you are. I can't pretend I miss the music. I miss my friend. No need to ask me what I prefer. I choose the music.
Guilty party there. Thank you for all your insight, Mr. Fox. Ms. Hendricks, best of luck on your upcoming number. We'll talk later.
I forgot my lyric. Can you believe it? Me.
Well, you're not the lyricist now. You're the star. How does it feel being back on the boards?
Terrifying. Thrilling. I miss...
Uh-huh.
The stage.
Come on, Angel. We gotta go that away right away.
Oh, must we?
It's our last chance to land the number before we pack it in for the night. Here we go, honey.
Erin, I'm starting to think that you were right when you said I was all wrong for this.
Georgia? Break a leg.
Thanks. You can finish the song without me?
I'm a one-man band.
Robin Hood just left these parts with Miss Nancy, the new school mom.
Alan O'Dell, how does a cowardly lawman from the East know so much about the man I plan to brand? I'm gonna round up that Rob Hood and hogtie his fancy, Miss Nancy. He made a getaway. He left me flat away. At times like this, a modern miss should gallop that way. When love goes this way, don't blow your bliss away. You might find out he's just about a hug and kiss away. No matter which way, he takes that bitch away. Till he'll consent to make a switch away. If he's in Santa Fe or in Piscataway, I'll pack my gown and leave this town and travel that way.
known a man or two, plus four more, it's true. And if he stays or if he strays, depends on my lasso. It ain't just how you woo 'em, but how you proceed to pursue. Take it that away.
That way.
There's every chance he'll see you dance and holler at away.
That way.
Then if you flip away,
flip away,
rotate your hip away. Just wait and see. I guarantee your man won't slip away.
If you're the mate for him, don't sit and wait for him.
It's up to you, but if you do, too late for him. If there's a spat away, don't throw his hat away.
Forget that fight and hold it tight
till he gets that away. What's that music? What's that dance? What's that stirring? That holy cow, what the hell do I do now? What's that
music?
What's that?
I would like to set our pose for the Act One curtain.
Oh, sorry. If I may, I've gotten the chance to speak with everyone, and you seem like a terrific bunch of people. But I'm afraid that this briefcase contains some very compromising evidence about one of them.
Now, I'm not going to point fingers, but I have some additional questions for the person here who...
Lieutenant, an urgent call from headquarters.
Shoot! Mr. Belling, just go back to what you were doing.
Right. So, as I was saying, I would like to fix our Act 1 pose for the curtain. So, if you'll all...
Lights! As I thought. As you were. Looks like everyone here but Nikki has something to hide. There's nothing in the briefcase, by the way. Just a container of chowder from the Union Oyster House.
Is it Manhattan?
Yeah. Here you go. I've had a chance to speak with everyone, and I made a few phone calls, and what do I get? A murder victim named Jessica Cranshaw, working for a fraction of her usual firm salary. A distinguished director who despised Miss Cranshaw but slaved to make the show work all the same. A dancer choreographer who turns down the chance to work with Balanchine to do some song and dance for spare change. Ex-partners in marriage and music who inexplicably reunite though they no longer work in harmony. A one-woman bank named Olive Shapiro, who despite having no prior interest in theater, sinks one payment after another into this production. A company who celebrates when their show is torn to ribbons by the critics because this means they're at long last able to take better jobs back on Broadway. Now what does this all tell me? That Sid Bernstein had been blackmailing the entire company into working on this show. Even you dancers.
Yeah. Lieutenant, I have to think most people here have something about themselves that they'd like to keep to themselves.
Agreed. I'm not trying to uncover all your dark secrets, just the one that caused someone to murder Jessica Cranshaw.
People, I had no idea this was how Sidney got you all to work for so cheap. He's the one who handles the negotiations.
Well, he won't be able to deal in breaking the law. Ladies and gentlemen, you won't be blackmailed anymore. But you're all still murder suspects. All right, guys, you have work to do. You may have joined the show for the wrong reasons, but you're gonna press on. Because you have a contract.
And don't forget it.
And because Olive Shapiro deserves a return on her investment.
Thank you.
And because the best way for me to solve Jessica's murder is to keep the heat turned up on this pressure cooker of a theater. And lastly, because this could be a really good show. Take it, Chris.
Very good. So, company!
Heads up!
Checking the set!
No! Jenny! We still have yet to fix our phone!
Sorry!
Never mind! Last four bars. Bobby!
5, 6, 7, 8.
I'm headed down!
killer? I thought I saw our director sneaking around.
Murder is a very British thing, isn't it? Like a hobby over there.
Yeah, you know, if I had to bet, I'd say that he did it.
He did it, I'm sure. Although he appears with a posture that's pious, his principles hardly are pure. It isn't a stretch to believe it, that murderous motive was his. He did it, then hid it, and now he is off to a priz.
Oh my god! You can't sleep either, huh?
Knowing that someone in this company is a killer? You know, I thought I saw Bambi sneaking around. Maybe she killed Jessica so that you take over the lead and Bambi could get your part.
Well, that's silly. She should have just killed me.
I never said that.
You know, Nikki, if you ask me, she did it.
She did it, I know. With laughter she hung him, and after she strung him, he swung again. The facts that are really surprising, the morals are probably loose. She did it, then hit it, and now she is off to the loose.
Gow.
Sid Bernstein's autopsy.
Did they drive a stake into his heart just to play safe?
Chris, not in front of his widow. How are you holding up, Carmen?
You all sent out for breakfast and nobody thought to tell me.
Well, let's at least be considerate of his daughter.
Stepdaughter, and even though I was his very own stepflesh and stepblood, he was as cold to me as he was to my mother.
Breakfast is going to be cold for you to eat it now, folks.
Well, at least all of us have an alibi. Everyone was standing around the stage when Sidney got the old heave-ho.
No, the coroner says that Bernstein was struck on the head before he died. Someone knocked him out backstage before he rehearsed George's number and tied the counterweight rope around his neck, knowing that when the curtain fell, the rope would finish the job. He was already dead. Bernstein regained consciousness just in time to die.
Oh my.
So you see, he could have been killed by anyone with access to this stage, including you, Jenny.
What does that mean, Vinny?
We found a copy of Variety in the stage manager's office. Your office.
Chris and Olive have keys, too.
Well, then it looks like you three are my first official murder suspects.
Well, it's an honor just to be nominated.
But you're still all under suspicion. I found this little brown book in Bernstein's breast pocket. Look familiar? Each page has a name of a company member and a notation in Bernstein's secret code. Obviously a memo of why each of you were being blackmailed.
No!
Meaning, no, I wasn't being blackmailed, but also meaning, no, I just found more death threats, and they're covered with my fingerprints once again.
That's all right, Miss Harris. You've already proven yourself to be trustworthy and forthcoming. Just so very nice.
Thank you.
Dear Sydney, end the show, or it's the end of you.
No, Sid Bernstein died for nothing. He told me that he was going to close the show.
When did he tell you that?
In his office, right before he got hoisted. He said that someone had just that minute changed his mind about keeping Robin Hood open. Then he told me to save my money for the next Boston show he was going to produce. He went upstairs to watch Georgia rehearse her big number, and he gave me back the very last check I ever wrote.
You can give that back to me. I am not closing this show. Come on, Olive. Let's go put that check in a safe place.
It felt very safe in my pocket. What's the matter, Lieutenant?
It's been bothering me since yesterday. I don't... Why is it that Bobby...
What?
I mean, out of all the people on this stage, you...
Spit it out, Lieutenant!
You ought to be in the Fort Henderson Square dance number. Beg pardon? I mean, you stopped the show. After all, wouldn't Rob Hood go to the big picnic disguised as Alan O'Dell?
Yeah, it makes sense.
And Daryl Grady of the Globe loved Bobby's dancing.
Bobby, can you improvise a short turn in time for tonight?
Sure, but I don't know if I can make the costume change in time for the next scene.
Oh, for gosh sakes, Bobby, it's just losing the bandana and putting on a mask. Would it kill you to try?
Well, coming out now. Jenny, the Fort Henderson Square dance number.
The Fort Henderson Square dance number.
And now we're getting somewhere. And for the love of Mike, Aaron, we have to have that rewrite you promised up in the same boat.
Lieutenant, I already did it.
Without me?
We finished it while you were getting fitted last night.
To be honest, I think it turned out pretty well.
Well, can I see it?
Well, sure. I changed it to Rob Hood and his men heading up the mighty Colorado. You know, a real He-Man approach. Sasha, quick chorus up in the same boat.
Randy, Barb, a little help here?
If you wrote it just last night, then what are the musicians playing?
I wrote a brand new melody to fit the old orchestra parts.
Very smart.
I think we nailed it this time. Take a look. 5, 6, 7, 8.
Here we are, my shipmates and me, lost on a windy sea. All the planks are springing a leak. We'd like to bail, but we forgot the pin. And we regret to say our compass is gone, but somehow we still sail on. Because two heads,
three heads,
are best, as some fellow wrote. And what the heck, we're in the same boat.
I'm sorry. No, believe me, it's a bold attempt, and it's certainly got some of that vim we've been looking for, but something's still missing.
We only have half our writing team working on it.
I'm doing the best I can.
Excuse me, everyone, but I just had a thought.
Ah, how long we waited for this day!
If we're adding Bobby to the Candaceland number, it just so happens that he and I have been working on a dance routine that's perfect for my St. Louis Sue character. And him.
It's sort of a pas de deux.
Yeah, a pas de deux. For two. I'd be the wicked city woman who vamps the handsome cowboy.
Bobby would save a lot of time if he was ready to go.
We've only talked it through.
I'm ready.
Comment, Bobby's the spawn of your loins, yes or no?
Normally, I'd say over my dead body, but I don't want to give any of you any ideas. Sure, let her take a shot of it.
Come on, Georgia, we better tell the cast.
Aaron. I thought you were going to write us a better version of In the Same Boat.
We just played the new version. Didn't you hear it?
I did. Aaron, I thought you were going to write us a better version of In the Same Boat.
I am putting In the Same Boat into dry dock for the time being. Okay?
Okay. I'm leaving. Oh, please, Ellen, come back when you have a new song.
Thank you for the chance, Mother. It's called Giving You Enough Rope to Hang Yourself, Elaine. Maybe not my best choice of words. You always make fun of me in front of other people.
Perhaps I should leave.
No, no, Choppy, you have dreams of being in the theater. You should hear this too. Elaine, as a Broadway producer, there's something much more important to me than you getting a star turn. What? Me, turning a profit.
I've never been known as one of those stupid clocks, Elaine.
Bambi.
who pisses away a lot of her hard-earned bucks. Elaine.
Bambi.
But facing the fact your coloratura sucks.
Bambi.
Though it breaks your mother's heart, forget about the part. It's time for you to know. It's a business. It isn't making history, it isn't making art, it's a business. Shaw and Ibsen, take him away. And don't bother me with Molière, confessions never pay. Criticize me, please proceed with your attack. It's a business. I put 1 million in and I expect 2 million back. It's a business. So what crime have I committed if I'm putting up a fight? It's a business. And I want those paying suckers out there giving me the business. Every night. Am I getting through to you, Elaine?
I'm sorry, Mother, but to me, the theater is a temple.
What? So it should only be filled on Sabbath? Come on, fellas, give me a hand. Very funny. Back me up. The not the theater, so we can turn a buck. That's not business. Business.
She does business.
Gorky, schmorky, money misspent. You won't survive Yom Kippur. You'll never get through Lent.
But what about the great poets of the stage?
Honey, I put on the Iceman cometh, and nobody cameth. Come on, boys, let's show the lieutenant our lineup. Musicians in the pit, it's a business.
It's a business.
Owner of these premises cleans up and we're a hit. He's in business.
He's in business.
Union members don't work for free. Hey, Harry, on the spotlight. Blink twice if you agree. See, I'm not devoid of culture. My feet are on the floor. It's a business.
It's a business.
It's a business. Material, Elaine. That's my opinion, and I don't care who knows it.
Well, I think my dance number could be very provocative.
Sweetie, the only thing you could arouse is suspicion. Oh, joy beyond my wildest dreams!
May I?
And Carmen, how many more hours do we have until we are re-reviewed by the...
Daryl Grady of the Boston Globe.
Grady, you're not what I expected, although... I've never actually seen a picture of you.
Complete anonymity is a Grit's best tool.
Well, I suppose I shouldn't bite the hand that slaps me. But it's an ethical to review a rehearsal.
You forget I report on theater as well as review it. Your show is news, and I'm putting aside my customary professional distance to personally interview your cast down in the green room. With your permission, Mrs. Bernstein?
Free publicity, Carmen.
Poor Sydney. He would have died to get this much press. And he did.
Mrs. Grady, the green room is yours.
Jenny, the Fort Henderson Square Dance with Bambi auditioning a new section with Bobby.
This I have got to see.
Point your fingers, boss.
So let us follow the Yellow Brick Road in the wrong direction all the way back to Kansas land. Sasha, yee-haw.
Come every second Sunday of each month throughout the year. The women folk head out from town to greet the soldiers.
We bake them home-cooked fiddles.
Yeah, that's all these good cheer. There ain't no chance for romance when the dance is strictly square.
In Kansas land, in the strong never stray. Cause in Kansas land, it's perfect in the month of May. In Kansas land, don't shake that sassafras. Cause in Kansas land, there's lots of splendor in the
Then this St. Louis woman came a-knockin' at the door. A former farmer's daughter busied up in hot couture. At first a mounted cavalry thought she was hot to trot. She picked the bad guy Robin Hood to tie his noose or tie the knot.
It's bleeding.
Looks like just a crease wound. Did anybody see anything? Bobby, how many people knew you'd be leaping when you did?
Well, nobody. I was trying it for the first time. That was some fancy shooting.
Too fancy. Unless you weren't the person they were trying to shoot. Everybody but Bobby, go back to your places. You folks, stay there.
Hold on. Aren't we all sitting ducks here?
Whoever shot Bobby had plenty of time to fire again if they didn't mind getting caught. Now go back to your places. Was this barrel here?
That's right.
Uh-huh. So here's where the bullet entered and exited. It grazed Bobby, but may have been intended for you, Randy. Why are you wounded?
I am. Deep down,
You can ask him why.
Are you usually standing here at this point of the number?
Oh, no. I moved here when Bobby jumped to give him more room.
Oh, then most likely you weren't the target either. So still following its path, the bullet may have been aimed at... Nikki, were you standing here when Bobby was shot?
I'm not sure. Is that important?
Well, if you were here, you couldn't have very well shot yourself. I could rule you out as a killer.
You hadn't ruled me out already, Lieutenant?
Wait a second. Bobby, why are you holding the handkerchief on your left arm?
Well, it's bleeding.
But that's impossible. If the shot came from out there, and you were leaping with your right side of the audience, there's no way the bullet could have grazed the left side of your left arm. Guys, wasn't the skull and crossbones facing the audience?
Oh, I guess you had it the wrong way.
Yes. So it's exactly the opposite. The bullet came from behind the upstage guard tower, grazed Bobby at the end of his leap, went through the barrel on its way to you.
Me?
Yep. Here's the bullet.
But that would mean that the shot was fired
by somebody on this stage behind this scenery. Those of you who were off stage, were you with anybody? So the only people who couldn't have fired the shot are Carmen and Sasha, because they were both downstage of... By the way, don't we think that Bobby should play his dance much further downstage?
You know, I'm thinking of having the same idea.
Well, I'm afraid we're going to have to search everybody for a gun.
There won't be any need for that!
She did it. That
Mickey is tricky and slick. Stop that. Nikki, what are you doing with that?
I found it back there. It's an automatic, so I guess I can't use as a prop in our Western story. At least I got my fingerprints all over the evidence this time. See, there's tape wrapped around the handle and the trigger. Gosh, I might have killed you, Frank.
Hand me the gun. Very slowly, Nikki.
I have something to say to whichever one of you tried to knock me off. Knock it off! Lieutenant?
Yes, Jenny?
We're way overdue for our break.
Oh, sorry.
Back in 10, everybody. We're clearing the set. Chalfie, you're gonna protect me, right? There's already been 2 murders committed on this stage.
3 if you count the integrity of musical theater.
You couldn't be surrounded by more police than you are at the moment, Mrs. Bernstein.
Come on, Mother. You should get something to eat. If you're nervous, I'll taste your food for you.
You have no taste, Elaine. I've seen your closet, makeup, your boyfriends, and I've seen a couple of your boyfriends in your closet with your makeup.
You never have a good word to say about me, do you? Especially in public. I thought I did pretty good in that last number.
Big deal considering the 15 years of ballet, jazz, and circus training I paid for. My professional opinion is you just don't have what it takes. I'm sorry, but you volunteered for this life. Dyed your hair, changed your name. Why of all names on earth did you pick Bambi?
Because in the movie, Bambi's mother is shot to death by hunters.
No! Someone just tried to do that to me, sweetheart, and I noticed nobody's ruled out you. Come on, Olive. I've got the keys to the lobby bar. I'll fix us some Bloody Marys.
Well, despite what your mother says, you did great at that Kansas Land number.
Lieutenant, I really appreciate that.
No, I'm the one who should be thanking you.
Bambi, your dance really was good.
Better than I ever imagined, kiddo.
I told you, Bobby, just give me a chance and I won't let you down.
Don't pay attention to what your mother says. At least no one can claim that you're in the show because of nepotism.
Well, I guess that's pretty obvious.
Believe me, Lieutenant, Bambi isn't the girl in the cast who's used personal connections to help her career.
What do you mean by that?
Sorry, a stage manager is equal parts psychiatrist, mother hen, and father confessor. Whatever anyone in the cast shares with me, I consider privileged information. Besides, what I know, Lieutenant, I don't think you wanna.
Oh, Georgia, there you are.
Aaron, good. Can I talk to you through about burn scenes in a brown book of blackmail? Each page has the name of every company member with 3 noteworthy exceptions. You, you, and you. According to this book, he had nothing on you. And yet the production budget says that you're getting the same ball deal as the rest of the cast. So why is it that you're toiling for pennies when you could be doing way better elsewhere? No one has anything to say.
Could you blame us? If I recall, one of those death threats said, make another sound and you'll end up under the ground.
Exactly, but Georgia, I never read that particular death threat aloud.
What?
Nikki and the late Jessica Crenshaw are the only cast members who saw it, other than the person that wrote it, of course.
I guess Nikki told me.
I told her not to tell anyone.
I didn't, Frank. I told you I wouldn't, so I didn't.
Well, I'm afraid, Georgia, I'll have to book you under suspicion of murder.
What are you joking? Say,
Nikki, would you be able to go on tonight?
I guess so.
Now I get it. You want to give a little boost to your sweetheart's career.
My relationship with Nikki Harris is purely that a police investigator and possible suspect.
No, it's not.
It's not?
No, I'm really liking you, Frank.
Oh, it's reciprocal, I assure you.
I'm very glad to hear
that. I'm more than glad. I was doing something.
Arresting me for murder.
That's right! Jessica Crenshaw's death. Please don't forget what we were talking about. Jessica Crenshaw's death gave you a chance to star on Broadway. When Sid Bernstein decided to close the show in Boston, his death kept your chance alive. You have to come with me, Mrs. Hendricks.
Wait a second, Lieutenant!
I'm the one you want.
You're confessing to murders, Mr. Fox.
You heard what I said.
It's not a simple thing to retract.
Think about what you're doing.
I have. This is a great thing that's happening in your life, and you know what? I'm not important now.
That's very noble. And yet you're on record for being dead set against Georgia taking the role.
No. I just said that because I knew if she took the part, she wouldn't have time to write with me. Be with me. That's how Sydney got me to work for nothing. It was the only way I knew to be near her. Stuck out of town together and huddle over a piano each night. I mean, who knows what might have happened.
That's how Sydney got me to work on the show. I wanted the same thing.
You did?
I do.
But you and Bobby?
No, forget that.
I don't understand.
I didn't want you to. Not until I knew how you felt. But you were as preoccupied as ever with your music.
Because our songs were the one place where you and I were still together.
Aaron, you said our songs.
Our songs. Our life. What was I thinking when I let you slip away? Oh yeah. I was thinking of me. Only of me. I think of spending each moment of each waking day thinking of me, shutting you out
sometimes,
making you wait
sometimes,
too self-involved to say how I do need you. Why pretend I miss the music? I miss my friends.
Don't
need to wonder what I would do. I choose the music.
The joke's on me.
Lieutenant, I hereby officially unconfess to everything. Except being a fool.
Aaron, our director needs to see you on the double.
Am I excused?
Go.
I'll see you downstairs, partner.
Thank you, Choppy. You played your part very effectively.
What a treat to share a scene with you. And a fair trade. You got Aaron to show you his cards. I got the reason why both of you are on board with the show.
You and Georgia staged all that?
Yes. It was her idea. A good one, I thought. You've been playing a part too, haven't you, Bobby?
I plead guilty of impersonating Georgia's devoted lover.
When we first started rehearsals, I asked Bobby if he'd pretend that we were involved again to see if I could stir up something, anything in Aaron.
Oh, good job!
Thank you, Bobby. Mwah! I'm very grateful.
Just a polite reminder, you're still murder suspects.
Right.
Bobby, I may have gotten Aaron and George's reason for working for Bernstein, but I still don't know your reason.
I always wanted to give the performance of a lifetime.
Fooling Aaron by acting as if you were in love with Georgia?
No. Fooling Georgia that I was acting. There's nothing I wouldn't do for her.
Except commit murder.
Even that if she asked me.
Oh, Frank. Why does love have to make so many people feel so bad? The public should be warned that Cupid is armed and dangerous.
Maybe romance should be left strictly in the hands of the police.
If you mean present company, I vote yes to that proposition.
Oh, Miss Harris.
Please, call me Frank. I mean, please, call me Frank.
May I be bold?
I already know you are.
I never believed in that whole some enchanted evening thing. Until now. The first time I saw you, there was a blue wash over the stage, and they hit you with a pink special. It was...
just like a musical, huh, Frank?
I thought... Nikki... I thought to myself,
you and I, we could be a tough act to follow. Can't you see special people doing special things, running rings around any pair, anywhere?
Sure you can, it's simple, really. Just follow me. Stop, hop, step, relax, stop, hop, step, relax, stop, hop, step, relax, stop. It's called a time step. Oh, wow, you've done this before. How about a spotlight of your own? Harry, put him in paint. Looking good, Frank. Looking real good. And with the right backdrop.
sure think I am.
Come on, gang!
Margin Gower champion.
So was I! Isn't that fantastic? Both of us having the same exact fantasy at the same exact time! Margin Gower champion! And your fantasy, which one was I?
Gower?
Me too! And the song we were singing?
Would make for a great opening number.
But no, actually, more like a finale. Would you like to go out?
You won't let me.
I keep forgetting! And I can't make any exceptions, although you are exceptional.
Oh, Frank, from the moment I first shook your hand, I knew that you
shook your hand.
What?
Shook your hand. Nikki, I think it's time you told me what Sid Bernstein had on you.
Nothing. Really, unlike the rest of this cast, I actually want to be in this show. I've gotten some wonderful reviews up here in Boston. It's the best chance I've had at Broadway.
Jenny mentioned a woman who used a secret personal connection to advance her career, and that I wouldn't like knowing who it was. Did she mean you?
Every show has its gossip.
Oh, Nikki, you didn't say no.
I made a promise to someone that I wouldn't say anything. I don't break my promises.
You know, in Bernstein's notebook with the code and memos about each person's secret, next to your name, he wrote a great big zero.
I'm glad.
Or maybe it was the letter O.
Oscar, the sandwich you ordered is here. For crying out loud, you need to get into your costume.
Sorry.
Folks, 5 minutes and we're back to learn yet another blocking part for In the Same Boat. Thanks, guys.
Jenny, if Nikki shared some secret with you, I have to know.
Don't speak near the microphone, Lieutenant. When it's switched on, everyone downstairs can hear you.
You tell me now what you know about Nikki Harris.
In what capacity are you asking me that question? Office of the law or jealous boyfriend? Can what I say be held against me, or will you hold it against me only if I say what you don't want to hear?
I... haven't finished questioning the entire cast, and I'm not finished with you.
Bring in the mid, will ya? Nice and easy. I'm right underneath it. Whatever you're playing, it's not from the score of this show.
Come here, my sweetheart, come here.
Who's that?
Don't be afraid, I'm not gonna hurt you.
Look, this is no time to joke. You've had two people die.
Oh, sorry, dear fella. I didn't mean to give you a fright. It's just that this cat, who's been with this theater for eons, apparently, has gotten trapped inside the pit after trying to chase a mouse. I'll put her in a basket downstairs.
I'm stuck here, Ben. Take 5. Q59, drop in planet Earth. Got away from our genius director, did you, Ophelia? Oh, that's funny. I thought you were... Hey, if you're worried, I'm gonna tell somebody about letting know and about you and.
What?
Jenny in the orchestra pit, and Nikki found the gun fired at Common, so I'm sort of hoping the killer's run out of guns by now.
But it's been hours since poor Jenny was murdered, so I still don't know the reason why you had me come up here!
Because you know the most about the technical cues in the show.
And why do you need me?
Last time I talked to Jenny, you were the topic of conversation. I'm not letting you out of my sight until I figured out her dying message.
Dying message?
Jenny knew her killer. Only had seconds to live, couldn't write, couldn't speak. Her bloodstains on the stage tell us that she dragged herself to get her call book and rip out one page, on which she'd written the words, drop in planet Earth.
But drop in is simply the words we use to drop in the set from up here in the flowers.
Exactly. Mountain drops in, skyline drops in.
Mary Martin drops in.
There's a drop of the Earth at the end of In the Same Boat.
There will never be an end to In the Same Boat.
The waves are webbing a lot. The
yes,
sharks are snapping
now.
A
same bloody orchestra part. Got a brand new melody. I mean, collect the entire series.
Wait a second. That's it. Of course. I've solved it. Quiet, get down from here fast.
Oh, retreat after me, Lieutenant.
Frank, are you coming?
You get started.
Okay.
I'll be right there.
Well, be careful, Frank. The killer may realize you're onto him.
Yes, but while I'm up here, I really should check what's on the other side of this drop. Planet Earth. Nikki! It's amazing how you can be totally stumped about something until it suddenly hits you.
Make that work.
No, this version's no better than any of the other versions.
This was Chaffee's big idea. Where the heck did he get to?
Something's not right.
Especially with this song.
I'll tell you what's not right. Us singing our merry little heads off when Jenny was killed just a couple hours ago.
Jenny, Sydney, Jessica.
all murdered on this stage. Which one of us gets it next?
Oh no, it's the killer!
Somebody do something
fast! Excuse me, I think I can use a little help here. Stop the music.
What on earth is going on here? No pun intended. Nikki, you must have pushed him.
Me? Why would you say that?
Because you and I were the only ones up there, and I have almost entirely ruled out myself.
Folks, I think I've solved it. The answer's been staring us in the face this whole time. Quick, I need to see the music for this number.
There's a copy of the score just off stage. Come on.
He must have fallen off a catwalk while we were climbing back down. What the heck were you doing all the way up there in the flies?
I was about to ask myself the same question. Nikki, did you see anything up there?
I don't know. It was so dark. I suppose I might have accidentally unhitched a rope.
This was no accident. But I can wait, because I think I've solved it. I can't believe it took me this long to figure out. Let's see. Damn it!
What's wrong, Frank?
I just remembered I can't read music. Never mind. Basic logic tells me that Aaron... You wrote all three versions to fit the same orchestra parts, right?
Right.
Then if they fit the same orchestra parts, they must all fit with each other, right?
Right.
That's what gives this number the kick in the derriere it's been needing. The whole company singing three different songs at the same time, and only a few chords sound like Baron Shaka!
But what about the murders?
Oh, will you forget about the murders for a second?
But you said that you'd got it, that you'd solved it.
Solved how to salvage this number. Now I want to run this down. Bring in the set, Jenny!
She's dead.
Oh, right, I forgot. Everyone, let's take it from the top. We'll lose the globe, bring in the river. We'll have Rob Hood, Lady Shaman, get the steamboat to Wichita before the bombers lose their land. Everybody on board with that?
Aye, aye, Captain.
Master Lieutenant.
Yep, Master Lieutenant.
Ladies and gentlemen, clear the stage. It's just George at the top. Sasha?
Ready.
Let it off. Slow.
In the steamboat, on the same sea, shaking inside as the tide keeps rising. Nary a ship, nary a sail, nary a soul on the whole horizon.
We're gonna do pal pal at the rapids!
Like to bail, but we forgot the bail,
and we regret to say our compass is gone, but somehow we still sail on, because two heads,
three heads
are best at some fellow ropes, and what the heck, we're in the same.
Headed down the river, come the damsel in distress,
haggard and torn, weary and worn, feeling forlorn that we look untidy, chewing our nails. As if that wasn't enough, they lost an oar. They find that all they can do to calm the craft for the poor little chum. They're so dumb that they don't know they're poor from their ass.
Now the pals go rolling on the bed while the ladies of the creek come sailing into view. Let's put it all together now. 5, 6, 7, 8.
Easy goes the oar, shaking its eyes and tiny cries.
Greatly improving the likelihood that I will be taking credit for it.
Great work, Sophie.
I agree. But what about the killer?
The clue has to be The answer has to be in the clue that Jenny left us. Drop in planet Earth. The Earth on this stage, the world on a stage.
All the world's a stage? Shakespeare?
Shakespeare. These are actors where all spirits are melted in the air. Oh yes, that's what Jenny meant. Chris!
I did it! So, I always take credit for everything. What do you want?
I need to see the final moments of the show when Jessica collapsed.
The company bows, that's the last thing we need to be rehearsing.
You don't think I know that? Please.
Very well. The company bows, everyone.
Technical fair, I'll need Jenny's microphone. Nikki. Listen, I know a way to wrap this up fast, but it may put you at some risk.
Frank, do what you have to do.
Folks, I have a little announcement for the cast and my men downstairs. Nikki and I are getting engaged. Yes, Nikki will be leaving the show after its run in Boston and creating the role of Miss Lieutenant Frank Chalky. Now, I want to run this just before Jessica took her vows.
Congratulations, Lieutenant.
Thank you, we're very happy. Harmon, Olive, Aaron, you said you were watching from the house last night. Watch for me, tell me if you see anything different. Sasha? Go. So weird to see people taking bows without any applause.
No, it's pretty much like the song of Midnight.
Faces, where the future waits for you and me.
It's Countess forever, and forever are they gone. I see those wide open spaces.
You're...
Barb?
What? You're in this show.
Well, during the vows, I have a quick change into a dress to give these plastic flowers to Jessica.
She demanded a bouquet after every performance. She also wanted us to play the Star Spangled Banner to guarantee her a standing ovation.
Yeah, I walked down the aisle and handed these flowers to Jessica.
So you put on a dress, take a bouquet, hand it to Jessica, and what would she be doing?
Well, she'd be singing.
And did anyone notice anything different on opening night?
Lieutenant, now that you mention it, I think when she took the flowers, she put her hand to her mouth, like she was covering a yacht or something.
Or like something that just struck her throat.
Well, when you put it that way, yeah.
I noticed that too, right after Jessica took the second bouquet.
The second bouquet?
Yes, she received two bouquets on opening night.
Oh, yeah.
One from Barb in this aisle, and another from someone standing right here in this aisle. He was wearing a tuxedo, but his flowers hid his face.
Yeah, I noticed it myself, but I just figured Carmen had hired an extra hand for opening night.
To boost Jessica's ego? Not a chance.
Maybe someone genuinely liked Jessica's performance.
No, I think we can rule that one out.
So that's it. The killer knew about the bouquet on opening night, came down the aisle with their own flowers, which hit both their face in something as simple as a pellet gun. Then fire the castle at point-blank range into Jessica's mouth as she sang. And that's how your star was murdered on stage in full view of you and your audience.
But that means we're all in the clear.
Oh, no. Not everyone was on stage at that moment. Mr. Belling, where were you?
Taking a walk, as you damn well know.
Aaron, you said you were at the back of the theater?
Yeah, and like every other man in the audience on opening night, I was wearing a tuxedo.
I'll swear that I was standing with him the whole time.
I'm sure you would. Olive?
I was with Carmen in the last row of the orchestra. I think she would have noticed if I got up out of my seat and headed for the stage.
That's right.
That's so very right. One person alone had both perfect opportunity and a powerful motive.
Shelby! Somebody hit me.
But if that's Bobby, then who is this?
Your devoted admirer, Nikki. Determined to bring the curtain down on Robin Hood, because if this show went to Broadway, you'd leave his sphere of influence. A sphere represented by the circle next to your name in Bernstein's notebook. A sphere that was the final clue Jenny left us before she died. A planet called Earth. Or as Shakespeare put it, the Great Globe itself. The Boston Globe and its senior critic, Daryl Grady.
Terrible job, we are no one that want to see your face again.
Easy, Grady.
Easy for you to say. You're going to marry her! I heard you say it over the house meeting.
She loves you. She never loved me.
Frank, I swear I didn't know.
But you did know, didn't she, Daryl? You shall publicity. Your picture has never been taken, and yet yesterday Nikki walked right up to you and tried to shake your hand to thank you for the compliments you paid her.
I asked her not to tell anyone so I could still praise and put Kramer in my reviews.
But he was just a friend giving me advice. It was never more than that.
He was more than that to me, Nikki! I needed you to stay here where I could hail you and guide you. But this inferno musical was going to Broadway, no matter what I wrote about it. And that's what Sid Bernstein said.
And yet, watching in previews, you saw your opportunity to make sure that Jessica Cranshaw never made it to Broadway. Being a critic on opening night, you could rush into your seat after the finale without anyone raising an eyebrow. Grab a bouquet you left in the lobby and come straight down the aisle as the ultimate showstopper.
Yes, and I tried to sandbag you and Jude Carmen, just like I shot Jessica and Jenny. Imperfect performances on my part. But one learns from their mistakes, right, Nikki?
Daryl, I notice you're out of guns. How far from this theater do you think we're gonna get without one?
Good point. Set your own gun down for me.
Wait.
Now! Get back! All of you!
I'm gonna take Nikki away from you now.
You already have!
Frank, don't.
Take one more step and you're dead. Your day.
And situations like these, I always unload my shoulder holster and put all my bullets in this gun. Come here, Nikki. Brady, you're under arrest.
Could my life get any worse?
Detective O'Farrell?
Anything you say can and will be used against you in the court of law.
Well, since you're all a witness to Grady's confession, I need you all to head to the green room and make a quick statement. And then you only got a few hours before your new opening night. Sasha, play them off, will ya?
Bobby, you okay? Do you need some help?
No, I think I'm, well, maybe I could use a little help.
Well, it's like I told you, just give me a chance and I won't let you down.
Chaucer, if Robin Hood ends up being a hit, I have you to thank. You ever want a nice suit and a garbadine? Just drop by my showroom. For you, Lieutenant, anything in the store. 10% off!
Suddenly I feel a flock of butterflies coming out of hibernation in my stomach.
Luckily you can't chase those butterflies. You have very little time and a lot of work to do before curtain.
Yeah, lots of unfinished business to take care of.
Before and after the show.
Any more notes before we raise the curtain, Lieutenant?
Actually, Nikki and I have this idea for a new finale for the end of the show.
Well, if you think we should be singing a different tune, I'm sure we will be. Oh, and by the way, bravo, the great detective.
Bravo, the great director.
We are excused, Inspector General.
Fine, Sasha. They'll snow again.
Frank? I swear I didn't have a clue about Daryl Grady.
I had more than one. It still took me a while to figure him out.
Well, now that the mystery is solved, is our engagement over?
Why don't we talk about this after this evening's performance? There's this little coffee shop where I'm on very good terms with the management.
Frank, it's a date.
Another triumph, Lieutenant. See you back at the station.
Great work, Lieutenant. You put life back into a show that was dying, and now they'll put Grady away for life.
I had a lot of help, especially from you.
Me?
You and your daughter. I told her how much she'd show me in that square dance number of hers. She was great.
Better than great.
Finally, to hear you say it! Give me a spill of flame in this rest of the cast until I saw how really good she was, and I turned to see the pride in your face as you watched her. You tell everyone it's a business, but I figured you out, Mom. Mm-hmm. You're the stage mother of all time. You married Sid Bernstein and put up with his affairs and shady deals to get your daughter on the Broadway stage. so that no one can accuse her of riding on your coattails, you belittle her in public, even if she hates you for it.
You can't let her know. I want her to think she did it all on her own.
You're amazing.
But how did knowing that help you catch Grady?
Oh, it didn't. I just explained why you killed your husband.
What? Grady killed my husband.
No, Grady killed Jenny and Jessica and tried to kill you because he wanted the show closed, but that's exactly what your husband was going to do.
Well, then he was killed by someone he was blackmailing.
Well, then why wouldn't they take his little brown book with them? Come on, he had to have told you that he was closing the show.
He didn't tell me he was closing the show.
He told Olive. Why would he tell you? You were his partner.
Because the partnership was over. He had himself a conniving little ingenue on Sutton Place, and I was out on the street.
Ah, so he didn't need you.
He didn't need anybody. Grady promised him rave reviews for his next 3 shows if he shut this one down now.
So he did tell you he was closing the show.
No!
Then how would you know the terms of the deal he made with Grady minutes before he died if you weren't with him the last moments he was alive?
He laughed at me. No more shows, no more dreams. After all I had to take from him, he laughed at me and Elaine like we were nothing.
And
I killed him!
Of course you did.
So, what happens to me now, Lieutenant?
On impulse, you killed your unfaithful blackmailing husband after he told you that your daughter wouldn't get the chance to do which you sacrificed everything. A decent lawyer might get you a couple years on reduced charge. A great lawyer might get you an all-expense-paid weekend in sunny San Diego. But you'll have to stand trial.
I know.
Why don't we build up your daughter's part a little bit, add a song or two for Nikki, and maybe I don't solve this part of the crime until after the show opens on Broadway.
You would do that? Frank, you give me all that and I'll let you walk me out of the cast party at Sardi straight into police headquarters.
I'll have you watch day and night until then.
I understand. But if the show moves to New York, what of you and Nikki?
There's always a spot in the NYPD for a Boston lieutenant who doesn't mind a cut in rank and pay.
You know what, Shafi? I think you're one of us.
There's a special kind of people known as show people.
You live in a world full of dreams. Sometimes we're not too certain what's false and what's real, but we're seldom in doubt about what we feel.
Lieutenant, you have experience with assault and battery. Bobby's still a bit woozy after getting hit in the head by Grady.
Let me take a look at him.
We've only hours before the curtain rises on opening night, and I'm afraid he won't rise to the occasion.
Oh, don't worry, Chris. The call of places everyone is like smelling salts to any trooper. The sound of the orchestra playing its overture will be like pure adrenaline. His aches will be bathed in the warmth of the spotlight. His spirits uplifted by the hands of an adoring throng whose applause will sustain Bobby right through the last scene of Robin Hood! Place where I belong, keeping company with the people I care most about.
You came to us a stranger, rid this place of crime, and gave us new hope in ourselves.
That'll be one tough act to follow.
Well, how's this? Will you be my lawfully wedded wife, Miss Nikki Nancy?
Oh, yes, I will!